we got by about these AI generated things.
We need our AI overlords telling us how things should look, because that's the way we like it.
And then in the center there, you have our logo.
Just click, and then you watch it disappear, you know, like using MS Paint.
I'm pretty sure this template is also about crypto.
Wow, what is... Someone's got something for crypto today, huh? Guys, pro tip today. I am going to show you how to be the most lazy as you possibly can. Well, I'll show you this. Have you ever heard of Adobe Express? Have you ever wondered how your favorite Instagrammers and Facebook posters and YouTubers create things and put them on the social media? That's how they do it. They do all of these things. Look, they even do TikTok stories now. Isn't that
great?
Wow,
so special.
But here's a caveat. What if I told you that many of these services, there's a paid plan, and you need to use the paid plan to actually edit these things? And then in my mind, I just thought about this long and hard, and sure, and there's something to be said for, you know, you're really paying to save time. And I'll show you why you're paying to save time. Now, I didn't sign up for an Adobe account. I'm not going to stoop that low, because I cannot stand Adobe. I've mentioned this before, Adobe is the worst company in the world, and you shouldn't give them your money when they offer subpar products to literally
worse than Facebook.
Okay, maybe not Facebook.
Maybe the third worst company. So we got Facebook, and then Microsoft, and then Adobe.
So you only really get two options, okay? You get Adobe Express, and you also have one of my personal favorites, Canva. Now, Canva is pretty much the one that started it all, and still probably is the reigning champion of all things. And they're actually pretty good at doing what they do. But Canva is actually a place where people is basically like Adobe Express. It's a big website where people go and create various templates to like literally everything from PowerPoint presentations to like social media posts. Look, even have like detailed PDFs and social media and videos and animation for people to use.
Do we have an inspirational quotes template?
Oh, yes, of course
they do.
Oh
boy.
It's right
wow.
here.
Wow.
A life without love is like a year without
Abraham
summer.
Lincoln.
The real reason we are all here today is because I am going to be redoing all of the YouTube thumbnails in detail, because I have not been doing a good job with this. I have not been doing a good job at actually making good thumbnails, and I am convinced I can be a better human being if I like, look at me being turning into Panos.
Be here with humans.
This is actually a template that I've worked off of for a long time, and it's okay. You know, it kind of gets the job done, but I want something different. All you have to do, I'll show you how I'm going to do this, because I am creatively bankrupt and I am a pro artist. Here's what we're going to do instead. You'll notice when you click on the search bar on Canva's website, they'll present you all sorts of things like Facebook. They even do Facebook cover photos, logos, if you're too lazy to make your own logo, animated logos, resumes. But that's not what we're going to do. Instead, what I did was this. Did you know they have a template for YouTube thumbnails?
Wow.
Because people are that creatively bankrupt. What's that? You want something a little different? Look at the stock man thinking very deeply. We also have intense muscle workout. Yeah. And if you're a gamer girl, vlog thing. Look, sunrise, it's music.
I'm now going to look for all of these templates in all of the channels I'm subscribed to, and I'm going to unsubscribe from any channel that uses these templates.
I mean, that's not the purpose of Canva, of course, because when you use any of the normal templates, you can go in and change any of the fonts. Look. Even the text is turning
I mean, off. I guess from one perspective, you could say, okay, this is... You use this as a template. This kind of just gets the creative juices flowing, and you say, okay, well, I like this idea, so I'm going to tweak everything, as opposed to just, you know, cookie cutter, this is the new template.
So what I'm going to do is we are collectively going to
hey, look,
pick
zebras.
Our favorite YouTube. Oh, you like
wow.
zebras?
Look, they're hugging.
What the heck are they doing?
They're necking, whatever it's called.
I'm looking here for a good YouTube crypto thumbnail. I want something juicy. Crypto? Where's crypto?
Crypto next move. Crypto,
the next move. This is too glowy.
It needs more NFT.
Yeah, I like it.
Can we say crypto NFT?
I don't like the color. I don't like this glow. Doesn't really scream me. Because here's the other problem, right? Anyone can pick one of these templates, but when you pick a thumbnail, you need to make your thumbnail easily
AI.
Recognizable and have people know it's you. We don't.
We
need
more
AI.
There was one of the thumbnails. It was AI something.
Oh, this thing. It's a premium template. Oh no, whatever will we do? Well, guys, I'll show you what you can do. If you write, it's a pro template and we're not allowed to use it, but pro tip. And if you try right clicking, it does this. It shows this menu right here, right? And you're like, what do I do? How do I get around this? Pro tip, if any website blocks you from right clicking, and this is true of both Firefox and Chrome, pro tip, if you control shift right click, you instantly get access to your right click. And this is because there used to be like websites would try to block people from right clicking.
Websites still try to block people from right clicking. Like try right clicking on Netflix sometimes.
Well, and then you just do that and then you get it. Then we're going to go to everyone's favorite tool, Inspect Element. Because the beauty of Inspect Element is what's that? Look at that. My Canva template is right here. And let's say I were to do, you know, just a little bit. Oh, they don't allow URL manipulation. Well, anyway, here's my next thing. Look at that. Wow, it's okay. It's a little too much detail. Because here's the other thing, right? Not only does it need to have like something that screams you, it also needs to be easy to reproduce over and over again.
One eternity later.
Now, your first assumption is, well, I am going to go and I am going to start editing things. I mean, after all, this is one of the free templates because, you know, I can go in and start changing stuff around and I can change the text and whatnot. But that's not what we're going to do. Here's what we're going to do instead. Pro tip, if you go download it, because here's a problem, right? If you don't pay the money, you can't increase the size, and 720p is just a tad too small.
Intentionally so
you pay money. But here's what we're gonna do instead. First, download this as a PNG or a JPEG.
AI upscaling.
Oh, you can do that, but then it'll look horrible. Oh, well, they're not even letting me download it. Oh, there you go. Downloaded. Okay, I now have the picture in my downloads folder. Now, here's what we're gonna do. I'm gonna make a new file. 1920 by 1080p. I don't know what this purple is. Just drag and drop the image into GIMP. Boom, you got it. Now we're gonna do GIMP. We're gonna show you how to be the most creative with GIMP. Because what if you use one of the premium templates, then you can't use Canva's own editor? That is a problem. So here is what we're going to do to fix it. And I'm actually doing this as R&D work for a video which has probably come out already because I am incredibly lazy. So here's what we're going to do. So first, we're going to go to layer. Okay, you should know how to do this. Pro GIMP tips here. Then go to scale layer. You can see this is a scale, and as you can see, it's as Canva told us, it's 1920 by 720. We're just going to bump it up to 1920 by 1080 and just make sure the numbers are right. Click scale, and look at that. We now have everything all together, but that's not enough. We need a way to separate this thumbnail-y thing from everything else. So here, on my computer, I actually have my icon pack. And this is this icon pack. I'll show them right now. This is the Flat Remix icon pack. If you're running Fedora or Arch Linux, you can get it. If you're running any other distro, I am sorry. You need to manually install it. But it's funny. You can get it on Fedora, Arch Linux, through the AUR, and the Linux distro, which cannot be named because it's used to hack people. But if you want to pick something similar, you can probably pick something like, I don't know, like the Papyrus icon pack or the Linux Mint icon pack. If you like the Apple square looking things, I don't, but let's say you do. You want to be more Apple-like. But we did a thing on... I did a thing on H-top. H-top and B-top. So why don't we actually pick a thing for them? H-top should be in here. Yeah, here we go. H-top.svg. And then look at that. We now get H-top. And it's because it's an SVG. You can actually size it accordingly. And wow, this list is just a generic icon, isn't it? Well, we're gonna have to go to the interwebs.
20 minutes later.
H-top PNG, finally. Okay. So you have to be really careful because what will happen is if you put something in, you can't just paste it in. GIMP does this partially as a safety measure. If you click on this button here that I'm mousing over right now, that creates it as a new layer. And if you do anchor, that puts it on the layer just below. And if you do this, it's going to get burned into the H-top generic logo thing, and I don't want that. So I'm just going to create a new layer. So click shift, click, okay, done. And now I can drag it around, do what I want to do, scale the layer. Heck, H-top's already low poly, so it's already fine, right? Look at that. H-top. But that's not all. What we need to do is we need to get something to get people's attention. So if I do Control Alt O again, back in my SVG library, I'm going to look for only the thing that summarizes this perfectly. I'm going to look for the trash icon because we all know H-top belongs in the dumpster sometimes. So click on here. We're going to raise the resolution of this one. Maybe it should be a little bigger. How about, I think 800. 800 by 800 is pretty good. That's an awfully big wastebasket. You put H-top here, and then you put H-top on top, and then you put it in the dumpster. Look at that. Oh, and then now putting it in just like this, this is not fun. There has to be a better way to do this. Well, what if we rotated it, you know, maybe give it a little more pizzazz, so to speak. Look at that. That looks pretty rotated, right? It needs to be something people can identify as an H. Put that right there. And then we're going to put, I'm just going to put it right here. So that way when people still see it, it's still readily identified as an H. We also get rid of this. That way H-top is in the garbage. It's a nice, good clickbaity thing, right? And then what I'm going to do is we're going to go to do the fun part. Or not so fun part, depending on the kind of person you are. Now, generally, at least with my workflow, whenever I do something really destructive, what I always do is, and this is probably a bad habit, which is why all of my folders end up, like, in GIMP project files end up really big, is I make a duplicate. Anytime I make a destructive change to something I've downloaded, I always make
a duplicate. Isn't there a way to do it with a layer mask?
Oh, well, you could do that, but... it's actually easy. I just find this easier. You don't have to go through a bunch of clicks.
Realistically, it probably is easier.
So if you go here and then we go over the eraser tool, and I've made it 196, but because that was just what I was doing last, but you can do whatever and you just click and then you watch it disappear, you know, like using MS Paint. You can see there's a little bit of a flaw when I'm actually doing it, but because of YouTube's image compression, I am pretty sure no one is going to actually see this anyway, unless they download the folder, the thumbnail, and zoom in really quickly. How do you download YouTube thumbnails, you might ask? Well, you go in your browser, you right-click, and you download it. Or you use the Y word, which cannot be named. That also works.
Just remember, and, there's no such thing as mistakes. Just happy that laxatives.
Well, we need to do something else. We need to do something just a little bit more. And I'm thinking we need to do something, the thing that will separate my thumbnail from everyone else's stupid
thumbnails. The black slash two-tone thing.
Exactly. We need to take care of this big section that's right here. So what I'm going to do, and this is a thing you're going to have to get really used to. I mean, even if you use Photoshop, you're going to have to learn how to do this. So if you just, all you got to do is you just go here and you press F. Can we get some F's in chat for all the people? Press an F. Then all you got to do is you just zoom in uber duper close. Oh, and make a new layer first. Make a new layer. So you can do Control Shift N, and then you can call this whatever you want. The defaults are generally okay for most people. And then if you go click on here, we're actually going to go and create it. Now, what's cool about GIMP is if you hold Shift, what it'll actually do is it has this almost light image tracing, so it'll try to, like, track edges on things. So you'll notice while holding Control, control and moving my mouse around, you'll see it actually sort of tries to trace its diagonal of this little crystal thing here. Now, I want to say that whoever created this, I know, tried their absolute hardest, but it doesn't really work a lot of the time. So instead, what we're going to do is we're just going to try to manually do it. I mean, after all, this is just a straight line, so not that big of a deal. So we're just going to go here, and then we're going to click. Look at that. We now have this line drawn here. And then what we need to do is we need to close the polygon. So if I just click around the edges, you know, like this, and then boom, I now have everything separated here. So if I just hit enter, and you'll see that the marching ants reappear, this time like this. And now here's what we're going to do. We need to add a little bit of a little something to this. And I'm thinking what we can do is we can do the red. I mean, everyone knows the red. Now, I actually have a text file on my computer where I can pull all of these colors out. But I'm going to go here. And if you click on, oh, I'll use it as an opportunity to demonstrate yet another GIMP tool. So if you press O on your keyboard, you'll see this little eyedropper appears underneath the cursor. And it'll actually show like the colors that you're using here. And then if you click, what that does is this now selected this red as my active color, and this red's going to be used for part of the thumbnail. I want to at least keep some vestiges of the old thumbnail, you know. Then we go over back, we can just go back over here, and now what we're going to do is we're going to put it in. So if anyone, quick quiz guys, do you remember what you did in Windows Paint when you were making your thing back in the 90s when you were a young whippersnapper? Easy. You do Shift B. Bucket.
I'm learning.
Right here. Click the bucket. Click. Look at that. Oh, look. Now it's a solid color, just like the thumbnail. How nice.
And I think I'll be controversial, and I'll say we shouldn't use blue on the other half. We should keep it black.
Oh, you want to do black here? Well, I'm thinking we need to do something else here just to fit the theme. You know, we're doing...
We need crystals, stuff, so maybe those, we get... those crystally things.
I don't like the crystals. I do not like the crystallies. If you go to Google Fonts, this is the fun part. You go to Google Fonts, you can actually go and download some nice fonts with good licenses for free, and they're not going to be like stupid Adobe patented color palettes, which are going to lock people out from using it. We're going to actually try to pick something
good. I like
good
paying
here.
$15 a month to use colors.
You like
Quicksand? It's pretty good.
Let's try Quicksand. I think I have it downloaded. Let me look. No, I don't. Okay. So, pro tip, guys. You don't even need a Google account to download Google Fonts. You can actually select this thing here. You'll see I'm using standard symbols PS, okay? What we're going to have to do is we're going to have to use the actual font. So I'm going to select Quicksand. You can now see that the letters got a lot more skinny, and we zoom in really carefully. You can see it has rounded corners, because all those young kids like rounded corners, right?
You'll notice the rounded corners throughout the entire product.
If you go to T, text tool, and you can go and edit stuff. You probably do bold, right? Look at how bold that is. So bold, isn't
it's
it?
Very bold.
And then if you hold the Alt key and left click, you can actually drag text around. So what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to drag it to the bottom here, and I'll show you why. You see how goodbye almost lines up with this here, but not quite. What we can do is we can try to size this font appropriately so it actually matches. I think 200 is pretty good, right?
Yeah, and then maybe reduce the line spacing a little bit.
Use this little slider tool here to adjust line spacing between characters. And then we can just drag this up so it sort of matches the thing here, and then you can raise the volume, so you can go here, and then we'll say maybe B top FTW exclamation point. Oh, and then you'll see that the text sort of trails off here. If you use a fixed, it'll sort of do like the hyphenated, you know, like this you have in books when a word's too long for a line. But if you do click on this and change it to dynamic, you can actually get it to fill the whole thing. And now we have more problems. You can see that the thing here is actually too small. So why don't we drag this over a bit, and then we're going to try to, scale this properly. So if we just shrink this down, you know, like so, maybe 184 is fine. I have for odd numbers, don't I? Drag it around like this, fits all the way, right? I think this is pretty good, right? And then what we're going to do is I'm probably going to pick white. Red and white. I don't know. It's got the... Look at that. Red and white. We were still missing one thing from this thing here. The box! The box! Everyone loves the box. I don't know what it is. You see this on every social... I don't know if it's because it's easy to do in Photoshop. I mean, it certainly is. But you... Everyone will come to understand why people hate GIMP or use Photoshop or whatever instead of GIMP. And it's because of one reason. Just one reason. You can't draw shapes in GIMP. It's almost a running meme that you cannot draw shapes in GIMP.
Why?
Because I don't know. So now I have the other thumbnail here. Again, O. I'm going to use the O key. Shift to your eyedropper tool. And then we're going to go down here. We're going to click on the blue and get the blue. Because I want the highlight to be blue. I want to maintain the old color status quo, right? Or we're going to go over here. And the reason why I centered the letters here is because we're actually going to be using the box of this template as an anchoring point. And we're going to use this to actually draw the letters around. So you can see if I use the rectangle tool. Rectangle tool is this button right here, or you can press R. And then if you just adjust this accordingly, you can actually have it fit like this, like so. But you understand there's a problem. Notice how that goodbye is longer than $500. What are we going to do to actually fix this? Well, the first thing you can do is if you make the bot... This is a hack that I created, okay? This is... If you do this, this is why GIMP is horrible. So if you go here and you adjust it like this, then what you do is just make the rectangle like this. You can actually use your rectangle to measure how long the box needs to be apart from your letters. So you'll see right like this, we're looking for the X, and that's the left number here. The left number here is 99. I'm going to round up and say it's about 100. You need to make note of the vertical length that your box is at, and you don't end up like me and stop clicking on it. But you'll notice it's at 0.267. You'll notice it's the vertical length here. The vertical length here is 188, so keep 188 in mind. So that way when I drag it over here like this, make sure the left point of the square is just touching the E here like this. Let them touch each other. And then we're going to do... Then we're going to just select this, and we can actually change the vertical length by typing it. So we're going to do 188. That makes sure we have the same height that we did before. And then if I do this, like drag the rectangle like so, and then I shift B,
use
capital
B. Use the little symbol that looks like a Windows symbol, but is, you know, far enough away from a Windows symbol. Just,
you don't even press any of those keys. I'm going to make a new layer, and I'm going to call this highlight. You know, because it's a highlight. You can even pick a layer color. I'm going to pick blue. Blue is what I'm going to be using. And if you paste, look at that. Now I have a blue rectangle. But then you move it down. Look at that. I now have a highlight. And it took me a million years to draw a nice, perfectly even square, right? I love GIMP. Maybe I should try to make thumbnails in something else, like Inkscape or something, or Krita. But apparently I'm too lazy. Well, in any event, we still have one thing left. Now the HTOP's in the trash can. We also need a background here, a nice, interesting background. And because, just given the subject matter, since the video was about, about a thing like BTOP and all, why don't we crack open BTOP?
Wow, so pretty.
I should let... And you've seen this already, and I'm just going to let this run for a little bit. Print screen. You can do window, because GNOME does this properly. Screenshot. You can copy-paste this image from your clipboard, and as you can see, I have it right here. I'm going to do Control-Shift-O. It's Command-Alt-O if you're on Mac. I don't know why you use GIMP on Mac, though. It's really bad. I'm warning you, GIMP on Mac is a whole nother... You think GIMP on Windows is bad? GIMP on Mac is 10 times worse. No doubt because of what Apple does to people. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pick the screenshot, pick the date. Look at that. I now have a screenshot of my thing. It's not quite big enough, but as we all know, you can just size everything you want because it's at the end of the day. It is just a terminal. It don't matter. So if I do layer, scale layer, we're going to do, do this. We're going to do layer, crop to content. This will actually remove a lot of the white space. You can see my thing is already scaled to be all of the content. So we're going to scale this. And I want this to actually be a little higher than 1080, so I'm probably going to do like 1100. That way we're guaranteed to actually meet the threshold, because I still don't want my window decorations here. I want to get these out of here. And then boom, look at that. We now have a thing. And that is all it takes to make a thumbnail. Now, oh, but there's more, guys. There's more. This isn't enough. What we need to do is this. This is just me being nitpicky, but it's
kind of true. Honesty, Canva what? Knows that you can do this. I mean, they're not, they don't think that you can't, you know, just use their images.
But imagine stooping as low to pay for one of those.
But they also understand that most people aren't going to go through the trouble of doing this, and so they just aren't going to worry about it.
But this is the point. I am teaching people to pirate Canva.
No,
stuff.
We're not using the P word. Using our creative licensing.
And, yes, we're using our creative license, especially given that Canva's license, and I am doing this on a free
and
template.
Using Canva,
which they let
as
people
our muse.
Do whatever they want with it. YouTube moderators or robots who are watching this, look, you can go in here and change the color to do the exact same thing. Okay? It's not stealing. It's not stealing when I can do it myself.
Canva is our muse.
It is merely just a placeholder. And I think we need a little bit more dimension here, don't you think? I feel like this is we're lacking
we need
a little
drop
bit
shadows.
The dimension department. Ooh, drop shadows? Ah, just like in the outro video. That's a great idea, Windward. Let's do drop shadows. So if we do filters, and then we go into light and shadow, and then we're going to go to drop shadow. There's a thing here that says drop shadow legacy. Do not use this. It's terrible. Just use this one. Drop shadow. And then what you can do is you can actually adjust. So it's actually really hard to see because this is already on black. But what we can do is actually reset this. You can actually change the color. What if I change to the blue, for example, right? So it's a blue glow instead of a black one. That probably just makes it easier for you guys to see. Why isn't this? Oh, you know why it isn't working? Because the layer needs to be sized properly. Here's what you do. Layer to image size. Boom. There we go. Filters, reshow, drop shadow. Now we can probably... Oh, you know why? Because the rectangle select. That's why. Uh-huh. You go to filters. Drop shadow. You can see there's a little bit of a shadow going here. I think we can do better, don't you? We can also try to do for once. We have 0.9. How about 0.9? You like 0.9?
It gives it dimension.
And then we can also change the axis here, so you can see how the x-axis, right? Actually, you know what maybe we need to do? Maybe it's not that. What we need to do is we need to increase the grow radius. So if we do is its thing. You know what would help more? Here's some more tips, guys. Color correction. Gibbs color correction is actually pretty good, by the way. So if you go to colors and then go to curves and watch this, you'll see this big thing right here. There isn't actually much to show. And if you're using like traditional, this is only really important if you have like a real camera. I don't have a real camera, so this is less evident. But you can actually use this to change the exposure
I like it
rating
darker.
Or the
color.
And that's what I'm, and I agree. We're going to probably go for
can
a
you tell we are
look,
dark
but, you
mode
know, maybe
users?
Not too dark. So maybe do something like this, right?
Ooh, yeah. Now the trash can pops.
It really makes that trash can pop, but it still doesn't remove from the colors that are already there, because if you were to just make it darker by reducing exposure, it's not quite there. But it really makes the black, that black right there pop. And if we were picking a different kind of thumbnail, you know, maybe we could do a different color than this. Well, that's it for today. This is how you can be creatively bankrupt and how I can waste 40 minutes of your life talking about how to use GIMP to trick people. Yes, trick people in only the nicest way possible. So leave a like on this video. Leave a like on this video if you are also creatively bankrupt, because I know I can't be the only one, and we can all be creatively bankrupt together when you hit the subscribe button and make big number get bigger. Thank you for watching. We'll see you all.
Bye. Later.